I've clicked onto the global tropical overview for April the 5th, 2024. Now, this isn't going to be a normal global tropical overview today. We're going to be rather looking towards the future today. We're not going to be talking about the current tropics. We're going to be looking towards the upcoming Atlantic hurricane season, and I'll be giving my personal forecast for what I expect as we go through the upcoming hurricane season. Let's go ahead and get right into it. There's a couple important points before I get to my forecast. The first one, this is an unofficial forecast. This is just mine, and these are my opinions here that I'm sharing in this presentation. And I do not represent any official agency. NOAA will release their official hurricane season forecast sometime in May. Now, another thing is forecasting hurricane seasons is an inexact science, and it's very difficult to tell you exactly how many tropical cyclones will form in any given season. One thing to remember that's very important is that no matter how many storms form in a hurricane season, it only takes one to make a season devastating, especially just for you along the coastline. Even though a season may not seem immediately devastating, think 2023, think about areas in the Big Bend of Florida that got hit by Category 3 Hurricane Idalia. That was a devastating year for them, even though most of the storms in 2023 had gone out to sea. So it only takes one, so no matter how many storms are forecast, make sure that you are preparing accordingly. And you have time, of course. Peak of hurricane season is in August, and hurricane season does not start until June 1st. And you can go to hurricanes.gov, and they'll have good resources for hurricane season preparedness. And Hurricane Awareness Week, I think is what it's called, will be taking place sometime in May. Now, through the table of contents of what I'm going to be going through in this presentation, first we're going to talk about my forecast for April the 5th, and we'll go through what I expect for tropical storms, hurricanes, and major hurricanes as we go through the hurricane season. After that, we'll go through the reasoning for what allowed me to get to the numbers that I have. And after that, we're going to talk about potential hurricane tracks as we go into August, September, and October, as there may be potential for storms to come towards land areas more so than last year. And I'll leave timestamps to all of these table of contents in the description so you can skip ahead to the forecast and then go directly to the hurricane tracks if you're not really interested in the forecast reasoning. So let's go ahead and get right into the forecast. This is my April the 5th forecast showing 18 to 21 tropical storms, 8 to 12 of those tropical storms becoming hurricanes, and 3 to 7 of those hurricanes becoming major hurricanes, Category 3 or higher, on the Saffir-Simpson scale, and an ACE, or Accumulated Cyclone Energy Index, of 160 to 200. And if you don't know, ACE is a measure of cyclone intensity and longevity throughout a hurricane season and throughout a hurricane's lifetime. These are compared to the climatological averages from 1991 to 2020 of 14 tropical storms, 7 hurricanes, 3 major hurricanes, and 123 units of ACE in any given season. So this leaves an above average hurricane season forecast here, and in some metrics we could be getting very above average, particularly with tropical storms. There does appear to be potential this year for us to get close to the end of the conventional naming list, which has about 21 names, only seen a few times in recorded history ever since hurricanes have been getting named. So a very significant hurricane season forecast, and now I'm going to go into the reasoning, what allowed me to get to these numbers. The first thing that I looked at was ENSO, and this is, for those that don't know, the region across the equatorial Pacific, stretching from South America all the way to Indonesia. And this is the index that you look for in an El Nino or La Nina. Last year, we talked about how an El Nino had developed across the equatorial Pacific, and that allowed the Pacific to be fairly active, at least in the East Pacific, and the Atlantic had some troubles because of that El Nino. During the winter months, the El Nino had peaked as a fairly strong El Nino. The Nino 3.4 index had read an index of 2 degrees Celsius above average. Not many El Ninos get that warm, so it's definitely one of the stronger El Ninos that we've recorded across the Pacific. But you'll note in the graph on the right that as we get towards February and March, the Niño 3.4 index, in effect, all the Niño 4 or all the Niño indexes there on that plot, have begun to decrease. And as we go through the summer months of 2024, it does look like this El Niño is going to be transitioning into a La Niña. You can see the La Niña already trying to peak in if we look below the surface layer of the ocean. This is a map on the right showing the water temperature anomaly with depth. So the further down you go on to the plot, the further down below the surface of the ocean that you are. And you can see that as we get into late March, we have a lot of significant cool anomalies just below the surface layer. And as we get through summer 2024, this cold water is likely to surface and kill the rest of the El Niño, and the odds of a La Niña being in place by the time we get to peak of hurricane season, which is August, September, and October, is high at greater than 80% odds as we get to the peak of hurricane season. That's the official forecast from NOAA. Now, as we look towards the La Niña, we start to pick out what's favorable for the Atlantic with a La Niña. As I talked about last year with an El Niño, you usually get increased thunderstorm activity because of all the anomalous warm water across the Pacific. And this causes increased vertical wind shear across the Atlantic, making it more difficult for storms to form across the Atlantic in any given El Niño year. In the La Niña year, it's completely opposite. You can see on the plot on the right, this is three La Niña years averaged out to where you have the sea surface temperature anomaly plot of each of those years there on your map across the world. And you can see the cold anomalies across the equatorial Pacific showing the strong La Niña throughout all three of these years. And this is more favorable for the Atlantic, as compared to an El Niño, you now have a lot of cold water relative to normal. And because of this, the convection is going to start focusing away from the Pacific, as there's warmer waters usually in the Atlantic and in the West Pacific, as the El Niño does help focus that tropical heat to the tropical regions of the world. So as that happens, all the convection or thunderstorms moves into those regions, and you start to get increased rising air across the Atlantic and West Pacific, particularly across Indonesia and Asia. And you can see that in this plot here, where warmer colors is sinking or dry air, cooler colors is rising and moist air. And this is favorable for the Atlantic, because sitting just west of this anomalous rising air across Asia and Indonesia allows more convection to fire over Africa and feeds the tropical wave train across the region. And tropical waves are a very common source for most Atlantic hurricanes. And you can see the anomalous rising air across Indonesia on this plot. And model forecasts do show this taking shape, as you would expect in any normal La Niña year. And you can see how that may favor Africa in this plot here, and could potentially favor hurricane tracks off of Africa. And this could favor maybe a healthy Cape Verde season, that being where tropical waves come off of Africa, move through the islands offshore called the Cape Verde Islands, and form into hurricanes that could be long track going into the Caribbean or potentially recurving into the central Atlantic. Another aspect of the La Niña is that you get a lot of air rushing away from the equatorial Pacific, as the air is trying to rush into where the air is all rising. And because you have all this anomalous air rising across the Atlantic and across the Pacific, you see a lot of air just rushing away. And in the Atlantic, in this case, you can see in the pink arrow on the plot on the right, we have anomalous westerly winds close to the surface across the Caribbean. And this helps slow down the normal trade winds that you see across the Caribbean, helping to slow down those winds and cause less wind shear across the region. Alongside that, if you look higher up in the troposphere, towards the top of it, 200 millibars, you have anomalous easterly winds across the region aloft of the Caribbean. And this is in line with the normal trade winds at the surface. And because of the decreased speed of the trade winds and the vertical alignment of these two flows from 850 millibars to 200 millibars, this creates a net less vertical wind shear environment than normal, which is favorable for tropical cyclones. Alongside these two winds, compared to an El Nino, where you usually get an enhanced subtropical jet across the region, you usually get a less strong subtropical jet across the Gulf of Mexico, and this can also decrease vertical wind shear across the region. One of the detrimental impacts of hurricane season last year was the very strong subtropical jet that we saw because of the El Nino. These two plots that you're seeing on your screen are from an El Nino years, not La Nina, and you can see the anomalous westerly wind at 200 millibars aloft, and this is some of the outflow from tropical cyclones, but also the enhanced subtropical jet. And this is just creates a ton of westerly shear across the region. And this is why in most ENSO or El Nino years that you usually don't get much Caribbean and Gulf of Mexico activity at all, because you just have very strong wind shear over the Caribbean. But compared to a La Nina, you don't have that strong wind shear, so you get more Caribbean and Gulf of Mexico activity on average. Now, we've gotten through what ENSO's impacts are, but now let's look at what's happening right now with ENSO. This is the current, but this is April 3rd's sea surface temperature anomalies from NOAA. And you can see that across the tropical latitudes, much of the region is water, which is one reason why we look at water so much, why ENSO, for example, is so important. And water also retains heat more long-term than land masses do. So it's extremely important that we pay attention to the oceans, as they can give good insight on what may happen months in advance. Now, if you look at this map right now, we can see across the Pacific we have an El Nino, but it is decaying. You can sort of see the signs near South America of colder water trying to upwell, and that's a sign that some of that cooler water that I showed you earlier is trying to upwell and come towards the surface, decaying the rest of the El Nino that persists across the equatorial Pacific. Another aspect to look at is the very warm tropical Atlantic relative to normal. You can see lots of oranges and even reds there across the tropical Atlantic, west of Africa into the Caribbean. And this has been a fairly consistent signal in the Atlantic for the past several months. I even talked about this in August of last year, of how warm the Atlantic was relative to normal. And just this winter and spring, we have really not seen many events that have allowed significant cooling of this to take place. And when you have a signal of a La Nina coming in and a very warm tropical Atlantic, that's a classic sign for an active Atlantic hurricane season. Alongside that, one last thing is, if you look towards the Pacific, and I'll note this in a little bit, there is a negative PDO, or Pacific Decadal Oscillation. You can see there's a, if I go here, you can see it more clearly, there's a cold horseshoe, if you will, of cooler water relative to normal off the coast of Alaska, stretching down the U.S. west coast towards Hawaii. That is a classic negative PDO sign, with warmer waters off the coast of Japan. And that helps to, alongside the La Nina, contribute to less tropical activity across the Pacific, allowing more room for the Atlantic to have more tropical activity, as it won't have to potentially contend with increased rising air from the Pacific. All right, so now we're going to go into climate model forecasts. And this is the forecast from them, and they've been consistent this year on showing a La Nina developing across the Pacific, like I talked to you about so far in this presentation. You can see it here on this forecast from the NNME, the North American, I think it's an ensemble of most North American models. And you can see moderate to strong El Nino developing, or La Nina rather, developing across the Pacific on this plot, with the very warm tropical Atlantic sustaining and the negative PDO signature remaining as well, with that very strong anomalous warmth off of Japan. You can see from another perspective, this is the SANSIPS comet model, showing a fairly similar sign of a La Nina developing, warm tropical Atlantic and negative PDO, and the European shows a little bit similar to those models, with again the warm tropical Atlantic and a more negative PDO, although a bit weaker on the La Nina, and it has trended weaker with the La Nina this month, and we'll see if that trend maybe continues. Maybe that could have a little bit of an impact on the hurricane season. But regardless, it does look like even with a weak La Nina, we could be looking at potentially still a very above average hurricane season. Now, you can see the distribution of rising and sinking air across the region because of the season temperature placement here from the models that I just showed you is what I showed you in an example earlier, where we have rising air across Indonesia and Asia. In fact, it looks to be centered on this map a little bit further west, maybe a little bit more favorable for the Atlantic. And because of the La Nina, you have a lot more sinking air across really the entire Pacific, a very favorable sign for the Atlantic. Now you can see as well in the NNME forecast, like I pointed out earlier, the warm tropical Atlantic here, with the warmth extending across Africa into the Caribbean, and we can also see the negative PDO continuing on in the Northern Pacific. Now, climate models is one way to look at things, but they're not fully trustworthy. We don't trust these models all too much, as they are very long-range forecasts, and they have been wrong before, and they can get some aspects wrong, like we may be potentially seeing with the European, maybe trending towards a weaker La Nina, but we'll see if that trend continues as we get into the summer months. Another good way to look at hurricane season, or potential for a hurricane season, is looking back at history. And these are some of the analog years that I have picked out. And these are years that the top three on the bottom had La Ninas following strong El Ninos, and had configurations in the Pacific and in the Atlantic that were similar to that of this year. Of course, there's not many that you can get that are very similar to this year, in the Atlantic at least, just because of the anomalous warmth. The closest comparison there is 2010. But there are other years that vaguely meet the criteria, at least for the Pacific here. And you can see some analog years here. I've picked six out. These being 1973, 1975, 1998, 1999, 2010, and 2011. Now, alone, some of these years are not the best for picking out for a hurricane season forecast. An example, 2011, that was a second year La Nina, and we're going into a first year La Nina. And those can have differentiating impacts depending on if you have a first-year Niña or second-year Niña. So for 2011, for example, even though the Pacific configuration is good, we're really not going to be using that one too much for this forecast because of it being a secondary year La Niña and maybe a little bit of different Atlantic configuration, as you can see on that map there. One good comparison is 2010. You can see that we have the La Niña developing with the negative PDO, cold horseshoe off the west coast of North America, and warmth off of Japan, and a fairly warm Atlantic relative to normal. That's a very good analog year out of this batch. Now, what I've done is I've gone through other years, and I've picked out the best six that I can find from 1950 to 2020 that matches this year. And these are the adjusted years going from best to worst analog from 2010 to 2007. And you can see, if you look through these anomaly maps, these are much more in line, especially the top three, with what we have this year. All of these years had La Ninas following El Ninos, strong El Ninos at that. Well, 2020 is an exception, but 2010 and 1998, those were stronger El Ninos that these La Ninas followed. But you can also see the Pacific configuration is more keen to this year's configuration, particularly with 2010 and 1998, showing a positive AMO signature there across the Atlantic, and especially 2010 being the best analog, having the more classic horseshoe of warm water from Greenland down west of Europe and down into the tropical Atlantic. Now, throughout these years, I'm going to be showing you the top three analogs, as these are best. The years 1995, 1964, and 2007. They're decent analogs. They have aspects of the Pacific correct, but they have more issues with the Atlantic configuration, especially 1964 and 2007. And those really will not be talked about too much here. We're going to focus mainly on the top three for this forecast. Before going into detail on all the analogs and why I think they're good, I want to show you the mean sea temperature and rising air slash sinking air distribution across the world. In all of these years, you can see the average of the top three on the left here for sea temperatures and the average of the top five on the right, the top three being a fairly close match to 2024, top five being a fairly close match, but a little bit different to the tropical Atlantic. But you can see in both comparisons or averages, the classic rising air and sinking air cells showing up here, as I talked about earlier, across the Pacific and across Indonesia and Asia. Now getting into each top three analog year. Now the top three are, again, 2010, 1998, and 2020. I think it's actually 2020 before 1998. That's the order I'm going in. So 2010, 2020, and 1998. Let's go ahead and first go through 2010. This is the sea surface temperature anomaly chart for September 1st of 2010. Immediately, you can tell that there's a strong La Nina in place across the equatorial Pacific. In fact, very strong. Now, I don't know if we're going to get this strong this year. Models are trying to show maybe the potential for moderate La Nina, but still, it shows a strong La Nina, or La Nina in general, rather, across the Pacific. It also shows a warm tropical Atlantic relative to normal, and 2010 is definitely the closest match that I can find to having this warm of a tropical Atlantic to 2024. The only other year that had this is 2023, which is a fairly bad analog given the El Nino that we had last year. Alongside that, you can see the negative PDO in place with the colder horseshoe of water across western North America and the anomalous warmth off of Japan. And you can see the hurricane tracks here. On the left side from the National Hurricane Center, we had a significant Cape Verde season. Fortunately, though, in that season, a lot of storms did turn out to sea, but we did have a significant Caribbean season, a lot of storms coming into the Yucatan Peninsula, in Belize, around Honduras, getting into portions of mainland Mexico and into Texas. The next year is 2020, and this is fairly recent. Now, this year has a few issues compared to this year, but it does show still moderate to strong La Nina developing across the Atlantic, still shows a warm tropical Atlantic and a fairly similar negative PDO signature. Now, something different about 2020 compared to this year is it does have increased subtropical warmth. You can see that there is increased warmth near Atlantic Canada on that map, and that makes it less of a good analog for this year, as models are showing that not really being the case here. But still, given the aspects that I just showed you, 2020 is a fairly decent analog, especially given that it was a La Nina year following an El Nino. And you can see here in the tropical tracks from National Hurricane Center, we had a very active hurricane season, very healthy Cape Verde season, and an extremely active Gulf of Mexico and Caribbean season. And I know a lot of you remember that season, just devastating year across the Gulf of Mexico and Central America, as we had so many storms. In fact, hurricanes and major hurricanes hitting along those coastlines there. Finally, 1998 is the last fairly good analog that I've got in this batch. You can see we had the moderate to strong La Nina across the Pacific. A warmer tropical Atlantic, though it looks like maybe some subtropical warmth, is present there off of Atlantic Canada, and a negative PDO signature across the North Pacific. And you can see the tropical track distribution here. Again, a significant Cape Verde season with storms that did recurve, but a few getting close to land areas, more specifically Hurricane Bonnie that hit as a major hurricane in North Carolina. But we also had some significant Caribbean activity, most notably being Hurricane Mitch, that's a historic hurricane that hit Central America. So with all this considered, now you may start to wonder about tracks for this hurricane season. Now, looking at climate models, we can get a general sense of what they may expect for tropical tracks across the year. This is the national, this is the NNME hurricane model, or sorry, climate model, for precipitation for August, September, and October. And increased areas of precipitation may hint at increased tracks of tropical cyclones here, shown in the red arrows there coming off of Africa. And immediately this shows potential for long-tracked hurricanes that could potentially ride right into the Caribbean or go just north of there and potentially become issues later down the line for the Turks and Caicos, Bahamas, and eastern United States coastline. Now, this alone is not the best way to figure out hurricane tracks. We can look, though, at sea surface temperature plots to get an idea of what may occur during the hurricane season. One thing before I go to that map is if you look towards Bermuda, you'll note near to below average precipitation anomalies across Bermuda. And this is in line with a region of decreased sea surface temperatures across the Western Atlantic. And you can see that that could cause a little bit of higher pressure relative to normal across the Western Atlantic, maybe a stronger Bermuda high. And this could force storms potentially into the Caribbean, and into the northern Caribbean islands, maybe towards the Turks and Caicos, Bahamas, and again, potentially an issue for the eastern United States coastline. And this does align fairly well with what you normally see during a La Nina year. This is the 500 millibar height anomaly plot from La Nina years from the analogs that I've just shown you. And you can see the usual higher pressure than normal across the Western Atlantic. And that allows more hurricane tracks into the Caribbean, like seen in years of 2020, for example, or maybe even 1998. But something that could potentially cause some storms to recurve is potential for a negative NAO. This is where you get higher pressure than normal across northern Canada and in portions of Greenland, seen here in this plot on the right. In a negative NAO pattern, you get more areas of low pressure tracking south of that high throughout the eastern United States, and this may allow opportunities for storms to recurve. Now, they may not recurve fully harmlessly. They could still recurve very close to the U.S. coast, and they could still be potential threats to Bermuda or Canada. But this is maybe something that could throw a wrench to the idea of the NNME showing tracks here that are going straight into the Caribbean, where this may at first glance give you the idea that all storms are going to track into this part of the world. This happened in 2010. You can see this 500 millibar height anomaly plot from August to October in 2010, where we had a predominant negative NAO, which caused a lot of areas of low pressure across Atlantic Canada and the eastern U.S., which caused a lot of the storms in that year to recurve. Now, one important thing is these are just two possible ideas of what could happen. Either of these could happen, and you can get the NAO flipping between positive and negative. A positive is the opposite, where you have higher pressure down south, and that could potentially feed the stronger Bermuda high, which could allow storms to go further west. So even though these are possibilities for storms to maybe go out to sea, I feel like there are significant potentials here for still storms coming into areas like the Caribbean this hurricane season. And these are my thoughts for tracks this hurricane season. I think that we do have significant potential for storms to come from the main development region, maybe come off of Africa, and track west into the Caribbean, and from there potentially going into the Gulf of Mexico or into Central America. Alongside that, I think there is potential for a negative NAO to show up at times that could allow storms to recurve earlier east of the Caribbean islands, but could still threaten islands like Bermuda. Think storms like Nigel of last year. That storm recurved pretty early east of the islands. Fortunately, did not threaten Bermuda, but was a case of a storm that came from Africa that recurved early, and I think we could have significant potential of storms recurving like that this hurricane season. I think the final most significant track potential is storms that get very close, uncomfortably close, to areas like the Bahamas, the U.S. East Coast, and go up towards Atlantic Canada. Seen here in this plot, either long track storms that recurve north of the Caribbean Islands and get very close to the U.S., maybe even make a landfall there like Hurricane Bonnie in 1998, or storms that form offshore of the U.S. and either go offshore or potentially make landfall as a maybe weaker storms along the east coast of the U.S. I think that's another significant potential for hurricane tracks this season. And this is about as specific as I can get right now. I mean, you know as well as me that hurricane tracks, even 5 days out, can be incredibly uncertain. But I think, given what we have right now in the forecast pattern, these are the most reasonable tracks that you can expect this hurricane season. And it does cause some alarm, as there is significant potential for storms getting close to land. And it's even more reason for you to be prepared, just in case a storm does come towards your area this hurricane season. All right, finally, we're going to compare the metrics of these hurricane seasons of the analogs that I have. You can see the tropical storm, hurricane, major hurricane, and ACE values here from the analog years. This is 2010, 2020, and 1998. And in the next slide, we've got 1995 and 1964. I'll give a little bit here for you to read it all. But this averaged out goes to about 19 tropical storms, 11 hurricanes, 5 major hurricanes, and 182 accumulated cyclone energy on the metric there for this hurricane season. And this is, throughout all this, this is where how I got to my numbers of 18 to 21 tropical storms, 8 to 12 hurricanes, and 3 to 7 major hurricanes with an ACE index of 160 to 200. So a very active hurricane season ahead, potentially here. It looks like we're going to be in for a busy one. And I'll have more updates on this as we go throughout the coming months. I'll likely try to update this sometime in May, and I'll have this out in the presentation similar to this that you've seen today on here. But thank you all for watching. I know it's been a very long presentation. I went into detail on exactly what I looked at for this forecast, but all of this contributing to a very active hurricane season is a bit of a concerning sign, and I hope that everyone finds this useful for potential preparedness for hurricane season. But that's all that I've got for today. I'll have more regular global tropical overviews as we get through into next week, as it looks like we have some real-world tropical activity ongoing here, and that won't be more next week, though. So thank you all for watching this presentation, and that's it for now. Thanks for watching.